When Bob Woodward stopped by, I asked him how the news cycle had changed from Richard Nixon to Barack Obama.
It's accelerated. You talk to people in the White House, as I've done extensively, and they just die because it's 24/7. Somebody's going to come out and say, you know, we're going online with the following story. What's your response? You have 5 minutes. You have 10 minutes. And this can happen at 2 a.m. It can happen 8 o'clock at night. That tends to drive coverage because other people are looking for a response.
With other journalists agreeing to run quotes by the Obama team in advance, I put that question to Woodward.
One word answer. If the White House had asked for court approval, what would you have said?
I don't think they could have looked somebody like myself, who's been around for so long, looked me in the eye and asked that, and I would have said, you know, come on.
Perhaps the biggest journalistic fraud of the year was Jonah Lehrer, the New Yorker writer who was caught plagiarizing himself and fabricating parts of a book. The journalist who exposed him, Michael Moynihan, described their last confrontation.
Even in the conversation that you had with him the day before you published, last Sunday night, he started to confess to having done certain things wrong.
Yeah.
But did he completely come clean?
No.
He continued to lie to you?
He lied to me in that conversation, actually. He lied to me in his confession.
How so?
He discovered that I had gotten in contact with one of his fake sources. And his fake source told me that I had never talked to this guy.
How does the impact of your work make you feel? In other words, how do you feel about what happened to Jonah Lehrer?
Not good. I don't feel good about it at all. I mean, look, you know, it is the job that one has to do in this situation. You get all of this material and you say, good, this is quite a scoop, isn't it? I mean, this is a rather well-known journalist. When you're piecing it together and you realize the sort of long-term ramifications of what this is going to have, the ramifications and the consequences this will have for Jonah Lehrer, that's hugely uncomfortable.
When 60 Minutes legend Mike Wallace died, Steve Croft and Bob Simon helped us remember him, not just as a great newsman, but as an aggressive colleague.
He had no compunction about stealing a story from you. Morley leave the office on one day thinking he had a story and then come back and find that Mike was already out shooting it.
People who have tried to imitate him have all fallen on their face because Mike never screamed. He never shouted. When you turn on television these days, you hear an awful lot of guys being aggressive and screaming. Mike never had to do that. He never raised his voice. He raised his eyebrow, and that was could be pretty devastating. And he also did something that very few people have picked up, which is not complicated. When somebody stopped talking, Mike would be silent. He wouldn't come in right away with another question. And very often, people don't like silence. And so very often when a guy Michael was trying to break down was confronted with a silence, he started saying something he really shouldn't have said.
We had some fun with actress Allie Wentworth, star of her own Yahoo show, and someone who likes to dish on her husband, George Stephanopoulos.
You know, George is a very private person. But this is a joyous thing, Howard, Allie and George coming together. So, you know, I gave him, obviously, a rough draft of the book, and I said, do you have a problem with this? And, you know, he loved it because it is a sweet story. It is our story. You know, I'm not Twittering pictures of him on the toilet. I mean, it's a nice thing.
He didn't take out a red pen and say,
no.
this is out.
He didn't, which was surprising. But I've also learned. I mean, early on in our marriage, I was, you know, blah, blah, blah about everything. And
yeah,
then,
you talked about your sex life and
yes,
everything else.
And like a puppy whose face has been pushed in the soiled carpet, I finally am housebroken.
Everyone remembers the Saturday Night Live impression of Al Gore. But Daryl Hammond told me it wasn't easy to capture the former VP until the debates. And that challenge reminded him of a certain sportscaster.
I went to the Comedy Cellar in the Village for fully a year, four or five nights a week, trying to find an angle on this Southern guy with a baritone voice who wore the mantle of nice guy, works hard, does well. There's nothing. I mean, when you have that, and it's like trying to do Bob Costas. I mean, Costas once said to me, why aren't you doing me? I'm like, Bob, nice guy that works hard, does well. I don't know. There's nothing there.
He wanted to be done by Daryl Hammond.
He came up to me at HBO. And I don't do a great Costas, I do a good Costas, but this is what he comes up to me, this is what he said, he goes, you've got the great Koppel, you've got the great Clinton, you've got the great Gore, but you can't do me. You tried to do me,
and you failed utterly.
It was a sad day for me when Newsweek announced it was ending its print run at year's end, and not just because I've spent the last couple of years there. Editor Tina Brown, my boss, called the move inevitable.
To be honest, I mean, in the last 12 months, I've had to just really adjust in myself in terms of feeling. I have always been a great print junkie. You know, I'm like the ultimate magazine junkie, always have been, edited magazines all my life, read them all my life. But my own habits have changed so dramatically. I don't actually go to newsstands anymore. Even on stations now and in airports, I find myself deciding that I'm going to opt for what is on my Kindle, on the plane. Uh-huh. And I walk through those planes and I see everybody reading screens. So it's one of those things where, yes, I'm sorry because I feel a certain romance still for print, and I always will. I still love books more than I love reading screens, actually. But at the same time, I know everything has changed, and I also want to go where our readers are.
And Newsweek published its last print issue this week, recalling the magazine's role in 9/11, the Monica Lewinsky scandal, and other major news moments. The scandal that utterly transfixed the media was the David Petraeus affair, which prompted him to resign as CIA director. As a general, Petraeus was famous for courting reporters, especially in war zones, as we were reminded by Rajiv Chandrasekharan of The Washington Post.
That access could be intoxicating, right? You were in that exclusive bubble. He would bring you in to meetings he would have with subordinate commanders, at times even into sessions that involved secret material that you were told you couldn't write about. You'd get to zip around the battlefield on Black Hawk helicopters popping into frontline bases. It's a thrill of traveling with a four-star. And for the journalists who got to be in there, there was a sense that you were getting to see an aspect of our modern wars that your colleagues, your competitors weren't otherwise able to see. It was a revealing, remarkable glimpse. And so, sure, that built friendships. And it wasn't just that. Petraeus was an assiduous emailer, Howie. You know, I joke there were times...
Yes, we've learned something about that.
Well, yes. And I wasn't meaning to crack a joke here, but, there were times I would joke to my wife that Petraeus could respond to an email faster than she would respond to me. If you had a question about something, certainly that would on a story that had something to do with him, he'd get back really quickly, oftentimes with a couple of paragraphs.